I hope you all had a fabulous Easter break. The sun shone a little bit. We took Tuesday off because we had some other things going on, but here we are. It's Thursday evening. And I love these evenings. I love the fact that we can come and we can hang out together and just talk about your journey, the fact that you're climbing the mountain. We talk about Kilimanjaro. We talk about getting ready, 10,000 hours. Will it make the boat go faster? You know, doing those things that mean that you can climb this mountain that's in front of you, or that you can, you know, choose whatever metaphor you want, but it's basically about being great. It's about finding success. And it's about talking to people who've been there and had their own journey. They've had their own challenges. They've been successful. They've struggled. Everything is, you know, there've been tears. There's been laughter. You look at people sometimes, I think, and you just think it's all been plain sailing for them. Look at them. Look how successful they are. Look how great, you know, life is for them. So you think they're 40, they're 50, they're 60. Wow. You know, life has just been easy. It's never easy, my friends. The fact is, for every single one of us, it's a journey, it's a challenge. There've been times when I just didn't know, I just was so tired, I just was so frustrated, I just was so miserable, just everything, I didn't want to carry on. We've all been there, right? So I want to tell you a little bit about that, draw it out, and talk to people, ask them to be vulnerable, ask them to put themselves out there a little bit, so that you also can ask questions. And the kind of things we want to know is, can you learn how to be a great leader? Can you learn this stuff early? You know, there's so many things that I wish I'd known when I started out that I know now. I mean, now I know a ton of stuff. I don't know everything, but I know a lot. And I've learned it, a lot of it, the hard way. I wish someone had told me this stuff when I was starting out and I was at your part of the, you know, part of the curve. And that's what this is about. It's trying to draw some of that out. And then you get to practice it. You get to make notes. I love the fact that, by the way, that some of you come to all of these sessions. Some of you come to all of them and you make notes and then you go back and you watch them. I promise you, this is the way to do it. There are some people who never come to these sessions. They don't get the magic. They're going to figure our stuff out the hard way. They'll get there in the end, but it's going to be hard. And it doesn't have to be that hard. You can be here, come to all of these sessions, tell other people about them, bring them all along. So anyway, enough of that. I want to introduce our guest this evening, Michael Barrington-Hibbert. Michael's a great friend of mine. He's got a fantastic story to tell. He was a footballer at one time. He went to the States, he's worked in business, he's set up his own company, which, by the way, is never an easy thing to do. So he's an entrepreneur, he's working in this space. So he sees a lot of people, he's great at building relationships. He's a fabulous guy. I love talking to him whenever I do. It's always great. And he's had huge successes and he's had challenges, everything in the mix. So Michael, thank you very much for joining us.
Well, thank you for having me, and thank you, Stuart. Thank you to all the wonderful interns on this call, and congratulations on being a part of this incredible journey. But thank you very much for having me.
Yeah, it's great. Now, listen, I said that you were a footballer. Let's just start with that. Let's break some ice a little bit. Tell us a bit about, let's go back in the day.
Now, David, listen, I never like to talk about my football career. However, you know, this is a team that I used to play for many years
ago. Okay. Did I see, like, it's blue and it's like, okay.
It's Chelsea Football Club. I don't really want to talk about me and how great I was as a footballer and, you know, playing for England as a youth team player, playing at Wembley Stadium.
Are you serious?
I'm not all about that, Dowd. It's not all about me.
I get it. Tell us a bit. A little bit here and there.
I'll tell you a little bit. And in some respects, and you mentioned about vulnerability, and I think on this call, I really want to be, you know, brutally honest to everyone on this call, and potentially people who are watching it on YouTube. Every single one of you who are involved in 110,000 black interns are far more advanced than I was at my age. And what I mean by that is, you know, you're in full-time education, you're participating in this. Again, Dawid mentions about climbing Kilimanjaro and about being prepared, and it's about mindset. So when I grew up, and some of the things we'll talk about, I grew up in a single parent household, and where we lived in a council house, my first CEO that I met was my mum, okay? So she was managing a distressed company, limited balance sheet, but she was resourceful, she was entrepreneurial. She led my brother and I by example. She had multiple jobs, okay? But in terms of where we grew up, the options to potentially get out of our council house, It was either sports, and I won't reference names of people in the 80s because many of you won't know who they are, but it was sports, it was music. Unfortunately, I'm a bad musician. I can't dance. So for me, it was trying to get out of my situation by utilizing sports. Now, the reason it was sports, not education, is that I wasn't brave enough in school to put my hand up and ask questions. Because at my school, the mindset was being smart wasn't being black. Asking questions wasn't being cool. And I go back to my last class at school, 16. It was a PE class, physical education. And my teacher was called Mrs. Woodrow. And she asked a question around what the social demographics difference between fans that follow rugby league and rugby union. And I was sat at the back of the class and I thought, I know this. And I put my hand up and Mrs. Woodrow looked around the room and she sort of had an exacerbated look about her. She said, Michael, what's the answer? You know, she's expecting me to tell a joke. And I said, well, look, the origins of rugby union is it's more of a middle class sports and rugby league is more northern based, working class, et cetera, et cetera. And she shook her head. And I get emotional about this because I now understand what she meant. And she said, you've wasted yourself. You've wasted yourself. So when I make reference point to the 91 people on this call today, I genuinely admire you, respect you for being brave, for being at the front of the class and not being afraid of failure. So that's my origin. So again, football for me was a cop-out. It was easy. I could turn up, I can play, I can score goals. The reason why you haven't heard of me on BBC One with Ian Wright on Match of the Day or Sky Sports with Roy Keane, it goes back to mentality. It goes back to mindset. So to climb Kilimanjaro, you can't turn up the bottom of the mountain without the right equipment, with not training, and expecting to be able to go. So when I first turned up as a 16-year-old, in a professional football club, I wasn't ready for the mindset. Because how I played when I wanted to. Mm-hmm. The reason why I'm not a superstar is that it started early that I wasn't in that right mindset to be a success. And fortunately, that is the best thing that happened to me. So from playing with England under 16s, I was working at a petrol station by the time I was 20. My house had been repossessed. I had to sell my car and I had to move back in with my parents at 20. That was the most humbling experience for me because everything that was associated with who I was as Michael Barrington-Hibbert, the footballer who was going to buy a house for his mum, was taken away from me. So Dawid mentioned that I had the opportunity to go to the States, but I went to the States realizing that this was the last chance saloon, that I had to embrace the failure. I had to own the failure. But in order for me to progress, I had to embrace education.
Michael, let me just jump in there. So you've really opened up in a very powerful way. Just tell us a little bit about what happened between 16 and 20. You're at 16 or 15, 16. You're clearly super talented.
Yeah.
But, you know, and the dream, I guess, as you say, I mean, we're talking about Chelsea here, right? I mean, this, you're not messing around. This is serious. This is a serious team. And something goes wrong. And you said it wasn't the right mindset. What mindset did you need to have that you didn't have that by the time you were 20, you were like, you were down on your, you know, it just wasn't happening?
Okay, that's a great question. Look, you're a business owner, a very successful business owner, but it comes down to consistency. So I turned up the first day of work thinking that I knew it all, and I didn't. So I wasn't humble. I was uncoachable. I didn't take on feedback. So a number of aspects that I'm sharing with you will resonate with the 95 interns on this call today in terms of being humble and embracing and taking on constructive feedback. Now, I'm sure we've all worked with people, Dawid, Stuart, Jonathan, Wall, who are super talented, okay? I was super talented, but the mindset difference of people who went on to playing World Cups, I played with people who were sold for 30, 40 million pounds, okay, at 17, 18. They were not any different to me. Michael Owen, John Terry, Frank Lampard were all my generation, people that I played with. Mm. The difference was consistency. They went into work to work. They went into work to learn. They went into work to get better, but also to focus on their weaknesses. That 3-4 year period of me being a professional footballer, Dawid, I just loved being a professional footballer. I loved signing signatures. I loved going to the nightclubs and dropping a few shapes. And I wasn't prepared to put in the hard work. So this completely resonates. So when you speak to former professional athletes and they might say, oh, I got injured or I was unlucky. I own this. It was on me. And that was my biggest motivation going to the US because I knew it was the last chance saloon for me.
So tell us, this is very powerful. So tell us a bit about the US. You arrive in the US. And you now know that you're at the start of your 20s, you're so your third decade, and this is it, basically. Yeah. Talk us through what happens.
So look, again, I think it's important just to take a step back before that. So I was, by the way, working in a petrol station, there's nothing wrong with that at all, okay? But remember, I had come from that high. I was now living back at my mum's house in a very small room, and I was working at nights. Dawid, I was working at night so that none of my friends would know that I was working in a petrol station. So when they would call me during the day, I would say, yeah, I'm just rehabbing. I've got a trial at Coventry, which I did, and have a trial here. I'm going to go here, et cetera, et cetera. But I was in the middle, you know, I was depressed. I was fundamentally depressed, and I didn't really know how I was going to escape. Now, in my life, Dawid, I've been very fortunate to have mentors. Your mentor, Stuart's a mentor, Jonathan, Faye, Adobe. You know, I've been very, very fortunate to have some great people in my life. And a person who saved my life was a gentleman called David Sexton, who used to manage Man United, Chelsea, England under-21s. And I'm very good friends with one of his family members. And they heard about my situation. He reached out to me and said, look, Mike, how are you doing? And I said, look, I'm in a bad way, Dave. And he gave me the opportunity to go to States. His son coached out there. I was given a sports scholarship to go to the States from an academic standpoint. You're looking at $50,000 a year. That wasn't accessible. That wasn't an option for me. So I went to North Carolina University for the first 2 years. And it was, again, very humbling. You know, I left school with two GCSEs, a B in PE and a B in English literature. Mm. And I didn't really go to school for a number of years. So when I was 20, going to university as a freshman and turning 21, and as a freshman, I'm in classes with people who are 18, first time away from university, was difficult. But because I had that failure, I had that drive that I needed to do what I needed to do. So after 2 years of playing sports, I was very fortunate to be offered an academic scholarship for the final 2 years of my degree. So going from the BP petrol station at the age of 20, within 3 years, Dawid, I was working in Wall Street with Morgan Stanley. Yeah. So again, that same drive which got me to Chelsea and playing England, and accepting that failure drove me through academia, drove me through in terms of getting a job on Wall Street, and has been the catalyst for me in terms of my career over the last 15 years.
Fantastic story. I mean, look, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, please put your questions and your comments into the Q&A. You're going to get a chance to ask Michael some questions. One of the things I love about you, Michael, is you just say it like it is, right? I mean, you're just prepared to put it out there and just be vulnerable and be who you are. I think a lot of, you know, so many people try to cover stuff up and we try to put on a face and be like, this is who I am. And, you know, try to portray our game face. And you're like, this is me, basically. And these are my lessons. And I love the fact that you're sharing all this with everybody who's watching. And, you know, there's a huge amount to take away from what you've already said. So pick it up for us now. And you come into Wall Street and tell us a little bit about that journey, because I know eventually you end up setting up a business. Yeah. And just take us a little bit through what happens now. You're now set. Are you set? I mean, what happens? Your mum, is she still CEOing? I mean, what's happening there? The family dynamic, that whole piece.
Well, my mum's the boss. Don't worry about that. I'll come back to my mum shortly. Look, I'm just looking on some of the notes. There's a chap called Felix who's one of the interns, and he's got a very similar story to me. Played for Parma in Italy. We've shared and we've connected likewise with winning. Look, I need to be very clear. It wasn't easy going. Okay, it wasn't easy going from graduating to getting the job at Morgan Stanley. So I think it's really important talking about how I got to Morgan Stanley, because after graduating, I've always wanted to work in financial services. And again, the reference point around Kilimanjaro is super important, is sometimes you don't know what you don't know. So in the early 2000s, the internet was still in its infancy. But I want to just give you some context that I was given the opportunity to get through to a final stage interview with Bloomberg in New York. And I lived in New York. So I lived in downtown. Their offices were Midtown. Yeah. Now, it comes back to planning. Okay. So in the summer in New York, it is really hot. Okay. So the interview to get to Bloomberg takes about 45 minutes. And I allowed myself 50 minutes. And in June, I was wearing a light blue shirt, a black suit, and I had to get the A train to the interview. Unfortunately, public transport is not that efficient in New York. So I then had to walk 30 blocks.
Ooh.
Hot. Yes. So when I walked through into their lobby, it like I'd just been for a swim. So I'm sweating, my shirt, which was a light blue, was dark blue.
Yeah, you can't be wearing blue, my Moran. No.
And there was a black security guard, and he looked at me. shook his head, and he said, look, come here, brother. He goes, look, go into the restroom, call yourself off, and I'll call them. Now, the reason why I share that is that I don't want, you know, the people on this call to fast forward to university, got a job. Now, I didn't get the job at Bloomberg because I went in. This poor interviewer saw this big black man, 6'2", just sweating, right? It wasn't a good look. It wasn't a good look. So I shared that purely just to give you guys some context. Now, the time at Morgan Stanley was tough, but I was in New York. My graduate class was diverse. What stood me out from the rest was I was British. So I was one of the guys. So being a soccer player differentiated me. I was passionate to learn, not just the product, but also about American culture. So for me, I was very fortunate in terms of the opportunity I was given at Morgan Stanley before moving back to the UK in 2005. I worked for a global executive search firm called Odgers Berntsen. I was the only black revenue generator in the firm. Odgers, wonderful organization. They specialize in board level appointments. I was there for 4 years, was mentored, tutored, and shown how the city truly operates. I had some great mentors. The CEO, Kester Skroup, an incredible man who gave me the opportunity to get ahead. So I think, again, I've made reference points of Dawid being a mentor, Esther being a mentor, Stuart, Kester Skroup. There's been so many people across my career which have helped me. So I think what's really important to recognize is that there's it does take a village to you know, push and accelerate people through. My village is just very diverse. I've got a white Jewish guy in Jonathan Sorrell, who's a fantastic mentor. I've got Dawid, who's incredible. You know, I've got, you know, 20-year-olds. Felix is reverse mentored me as well. So I've been really fortunate to have a very broad ecosystem of people who are continually helping me grow and develop.
What do you think is the secret, Michael, of a great relationship between a mentor and a mentee? Like, how do you think you get the most out of that relationship? Because sometimes these things get set up, and then, in a way, you know, you have the mentor, they have the chat, but nothing really comes of it. How do you think, if someone is saying, "I've got a mentor," how can I get the most out of someone like a Jonathan Sorrell or a Wal Collade or someone like that? You know, just so much wisdom and experience. How do I really make it, you know, make it sing?
So I'm going to talk from my own perspective. So I'm in my early 40s, and yeah, I'll be very open. So when I first met Dawid, I was super intimidated. You know, I heard that Dawid's reputation of being a diva, never showing up on time, you know, being very difficult. I heard all this about that. I'm joking. But I saw Dawid's success, and it intimidated me. And the same with Jonathan, the same with Wal. You know, we've got some industry titans that are my friends. But what really made a difference for me is I had to sort of be humble and listen and learn. And, you know, Dawid said, "We are good friends." We are good friends. Jonathan Sorrell is an incredible person. We are good friends. Because he's shown a piece of him, and I've shown a piece of myself, and the same with Wal. So I think when we look at the interns on this call, is be yourself, okay? And I've got no issues talking about coming from a single parent background. I've got no issues talking about being surrounded by, unfortunately, people passing away and getting arrested and things like that. That's who I am. I own that. So if I can go back to when I joined Odgers Berntsen, which is predominantly a white organization where the majority of the staff have come from elite universities, private schools, they were wonderful. The challenge that I had, I didn't fit in. It wasn't necessarily because I was black, it's because I wasn't true to myself. I tried to sort of go to the Henley Regatta. I spoke about things I had no knowledge of. And after seeing an executive coach, which Kestis Group, my CEO, gave to me, my coach was a white, gay, Jewish man, and he was bald, and he was 5'4". So he spoke about being discriminated against. He got it. And what he just said to me is that, "Look, Michael, you don't need to fit in. Just be yourself. Because do you know what? If you're yourself and you're authentic, people will be drawn to you." And that's what made the difference. So people that I know who are on this call, and I won't call you out, the reason why they've been successful, and I think the reason why you've all been offered opportunities, is that you've been true. You've been authentic. And I think you don't have to hide. You don't have to hide who you are.
Yeah. Listen, I'm going to pull George into the conversation. George has a question about purpose, so let's see if we can get George in here. George, if you can unmute, and you can even maybe turn your camera on, then we'll get your question. Hey, good to see you, man. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you for having me.
Not at all. Where are you? Where are you based right now?
Right now I'm in London, so I'm at the campus right now.
Good. Okay, tell us a little bit. What's your question? You got a question in the Q&A.
I feel like a big part of my purpose is based on my family, because when I was listening to your story, I kind of see a lot of what you're going through is what I'm going through right now. I mean, I work on the weekend at a hospital, and these past few days haven't been easy for me. And I just wanted to know what your purpose is right now in your life, and how you've developed that over time.
Well, look, George, thank you. Thank you very much for that question. I'll have to be careful just in terms of how much I share, because it's still very raw. So, you know, my mum's a massive motivation for me. Unfortunately, so I mentioned that it was my brother and I, and unfortunately my brother passed away a few years ago at 40. So my motivation is to fulfill my potential, to represent my family. Sorry for being emotive, I just got a picture of my brother there. But what, again, the reason why I'm sharing this with you all is because I still have challenges of just being intimidated by people that I think come from a higher social status than me. They're all people. They've all got vulnerabilities. It's not about where you start, George, brother. I'll call you brother. Okay. It's not about where you start. It's about where you finish, man. And, you know, what, as a business owner, when I look at CVs, when I interview people, I'm interviewing you, George. I'm going to go back to Felix, because I had to interview Felix, who's on this call. And he, it was the first time we spoke, and he was talking to me, and I stopped him. I said, listen, stop. Talk to me. I'm you. I am you, and you are me. Just talk to me. And that's where that comfort level started to come out. So, George, my purpose is to represent my community, represent my family, but also give back. And this is why Dawid, Jonathan, Wall, Faye, Stuart, Esther are involved in this incredible initiative, is because this is truly changing not just your lives, George, Winnie and others, it's changing mine. It's changing Dawid's. We're getting so much energy from seeing that the future is so bright and so talented. So really the purpose is you, it's my brother, and it's really about giving back, George.
Yeah, thank you. George, tell us a little bit about, thanks so much, Michael. It's powerful, man. George, tell us a bit about your own sense of purpose and your values, maybe a little bit.
I guess when I came to this country 4 years ago, my purpose was to help my parents and my family. So when I first came, I was working as a cleaner, and now I'm working at a receptionist at the Harley Street Clinic. I work on the weekend, so it's usually after school, I just go straight to work. I guess my purpose was to help get them out of that situation, because, you know, it's not nice seeing your little brother sleeping on a couch. So, yeah, but I guess for now, my purpose was that, but also, like he said, to lift as you climb.
Thank you, man. Thank you for sharing that. Lift as you climb. We talk about it. We say it all the time, and it's exactly what it is. So look, it's been a pleasure to have you on here, George. Thank you very much. We'll let you go back into the crowd, but thanks so much. And by the way, anybody else who's got a question, we're going to pull you into the mix. And I'm just going to read this next question out. How do you deal with a stream of failure, and especially near misses? So I have a sense that maybe someone writing that has sent out, who knows, hundreds of applications, they keep getting knocked back. And it almost feels like there's never a lot, you know, the light at the end of the tunnel. This tunnel is long and it's dark and it's cold and windy. And so when life feels like that, I mean, what's your own experience or failure, but dealing with it and, you know, somehow finding your way away through it and waiting for the dawn to come. Michael, tell us a bit about dealing with failure.
Sorry, I'm still a little bit emotive from what George mentioned as well. That really did resonate. Life isn't easy. Life is not fair. It's not. And that's the reality. Life doesn't owe you anything. I've just given you some examples, not only just from a sporting context, from an academic one, because ultimately you could still go through all of that and go to universities, get great grades, and for whatever reason, you're not in a position where you're being successful. I think context is really important. So if you are applying for jobs, I think it's really important that through this platform, you reach out to other peers, to myself, to Dawid, because there might be elements around CVs, how you're presenting it. But again, what Dawid, Stuart have been doing is running CV workshops. So again, the fact that you're on these calls demonstrates that you're in the right place, but ask for help, ask for feedback. Yesterday, I was speaking to an investment manager or someone who works in the investment management industry who wants to be an equity analyst. And I had to walk him through what they needed to do in order to get there. And this person is 32, 33. So it's a process. But I think certainly with regards to that point in particular is to ask questions. If it is pertaining to not getting an interview or getting offered a job, is to try and get feedback and speak to this wonderful cohort, these brothers and sisters that you've got walking this journey with you to see what they're doing. And again, be able to pull down that experience and take it on and own it.
Yeah, I love that. And you're right. Look, you know, we're climbing a mountain here and all together. And what's nice is that we're all lifting as we climb, and we're still all climbing wherever we are on our journey. And we're locked hands. You know, our hands are all locked together as we climb, which is what's so powerful about 10,000 Black Interns. It's not just one or two or 10 or 20 or 100 or 500 or 1,000. It's like 10,000, maybe even more by the time we're done with this, climbing this mountain, so that we get to a place in 2, 3, 4, 5 years time when it's going to be completely normal to walk into a boardroom and you are going to see people of Black heritage all over the place doing excellent jobs, really being at the top of their game, making a difference, influencing our industries, not just asset management, but across the piece, from executive search to law to accounting to, you know, utilities to energy. It doesn't really matter where, science, everywhere. We are going to be all over it, being excellent, which is what, you know, we don't just dream about it. It's not just I have a dream territory. This is happening. This is why we're on this call today. Michael, I want to talk a little bit now about what it's like as you climb the mountain and you start to look down and you realize that I've come somewhere. I am someone. I'm doing something to make my mom proud, to make my brother, if he was here, he would be proud of me. What does that feel like a little bit? I mean, now you've opened your own business, Barrington-Hibbert Associates. You're doing some cool stuff. I mean, tell us a little bit about the sense of, just for those people who are like, am I ever going to make it? I mean, you've been on that journey and now here you are. What does it feel like to wake up in the morning sometimes? And of course, it's not to say the light is, you know, the sun is shining every day and it's a beautiful situation everywhere, but just give us a sense of what it feels like to be able to look down and say, you know what, I've come on a journey, but here I am.
I'm tempted to throw that question back at you, Dawid. And the reason being, and I know what your answer is, and I know what Jonathan's answer would be, and Wall's, you don't wake up in the morning and think that. You don't wake up in the morning and think, I've made it. That's not what drives you. That's not what makes you special, Dawid, or Stuart special. So, sorry, I get a motive around that because I'm just Michael. I'm just a guy. I'm doing something that I'm passionate about. One of the mentors that I didn't mention was a gentleman called Roland Smith, a white guy. When I moved to America, I was still a little bit wild, by the way. I still like to party. So when I say drop shapes, it means dancing. That's what old people say, you know, dropping shapes. And, you know, Roland took me under his wing. And, you know, I let him down so many times, and he kept giving me opportunities. And this might be familiar to you, David. Like, you know, I say I'll call you back and I don't call you back, but I kept letting him down. And he always was there. And I said to him, Roland, why are you doing this? And he says, look, Michael, someone helped me. So this guy grew up in segregated Georgia. And it was given a Black kid a chance. And when I started to clean up my act, he came to my graduation. And I said, Roland, how can I repay you? And he said, Michael, the time will come where you will do what I've done for you, but for more people. He's the godfather to my three children. Unfortunately, he passed away a couple of years ago with cancer, but he lives with me today. So in terms of when I wake up in the morning, you know, it's about giving back. It's not necessarily sitting there and thinking, okay, I've made it to the top of the tree, because I haven't. And I think if I ever start thinking like that, I think I won't be who I am. I've always got that drive to be better. And I've always got that drive to do more and make sure people can go on that journey with me.
Yeah, got it. Listen, let's take some questions. I'm going to try and bring a couple of people into the chat. Let's bring some people in. Let's bring in J.H. Kidane, who's got a question. And then we're also going to bring in Mukuma Kawesha. And let's try, look, we've got a few people here. Everybody's showing up. Okay, let's bring in those two first, J.H. and Mukuma. And then we're going to ask their questions, and then we'll see if we can get a couple of others, sneak a couple in as we come up to the hour. Okay, JH, how are you, man? You're on mute, dude. Hit the mute button.
So sorry about that. I always forget to push that button.
Introduce yourself, man. You're on stage. How's it going?
Thank you, David. Yeah, my name is Jonas. Sorry, the name just does say JH on the screen. I haven't changed it. It's been a while. But my name is Jonas. I am currently based in London. I'm very close to finishing I'm doing a master's at Cambridge at the moment, but I'm very close to finishing that over the next few months. But thank you for having me. So my question was about the cultural difference. And I say this because my personal background, I'm going to keep it short. I come from a refugee background. So I came to the UK about 10 years ago as a youngster, and I've been living here ever since. And there's quite a lot to learn. There's quite a lot to catch up. And this is because I come from a different background. I'm from Africa originally. I'm from Eritrea. And the places that I've been to, for instance, I'm in Cambridge right now, and the cultural shock is immense, especially for someone who came from a country that no one knows about. So how do you, putting myself in these places, I've always struggled to kind of put myself out there, understand the cultural difference. And more times than often, even though I have thoughts, I refrain from sharing those because I'm scared what people might think. So how do you put yourself out there, especially if you come from a different background, and how do you deal with the cultural variances? I guess the industry is kind of, you know, it's global. You're more likely to meet people from China, from all over the place. So how do you deal with those?
That's a great question. And I might even have a go, because I came from Ghana. My mother's English, my father's Ghanaian, but I grew up in Ghana. I came here when I was 16. And, you know, I'd never seen snow before. The temperature whenever I'd been here previously was like summertime. So I thought it was always like that. Started getting dark at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Like, what's that about? And you know, like foggy, couldn't see anything. I mean, and I was the only black guy in a school of like 1500 white guys. And life was very interesting. And I think, look, I think you have to try to understand the culture in which you are, which you really do by making friends, good friends with people. And how do you make good friends? By being a good guy and by helping people. It's exactly the point that I think it might've been Jonathan made when he was on here, which is this, you know, you help people. That's what you do. That's how you are a helpful guy. You are a good guy. You are a nice guy. And I think slowly you get to understand where people are coming from. You know, when I first arrived here, I as we say in Ghana, I vexed with just about everybody. I mean, I was just a vexed guy, you know? I mean, they call me all kinds of names. And then I realized that, you know what, actually, you're not my enemy. It took me some time, but eventually I settled in. And then I realized that just be authentic, be yourself, and be a good person. And you'll make friends. And there are some fantastic, fantastic people in this community, you know, English people, Welsh, Scots.
Yeah.
You can make friends for life. I've got some fantastic friends, I've got to say. It's not an easy culture to get assimilated into. Maybe I think the British culture is one of the most complicated. The nuances, codes, just getting the idioms, which is just the way you speak, the humor. It's not easy. It takes time, takes practice. But I don't know whether, Michael, you want to chime in.
No, not at all. And look, thank you for sharing your story. And look, if you can drop me a note directly, I might have some suggestions, simply because I know a number of Eritreans in London who work in investment banking. And also, I know Eritrea is going through some stuff at the moment, but they can connect, you know, I can connect you with them, but it will just be a more broader network. But I think just going back to Dawid's point is the fact that you're at Cambridge, the fact that you've been in the country for only 10 years demonstrates that you're gifted. okay? It's about helping people. People are people. So I think ultimately my portfolio of friends are super, super diverse. So I don't think you need to compromise who you are. Be authentic, be you, stick to that moral compass and you're going to do well. But please drop me a note directly and I'll be delighted to make some intros for you over the next week or so.
Lovely, lovely, lovely. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, no problem at all. Mukuma, let's hear from you. Let's hear your question.
Hi, I hope you can all hear me. I'm Mukuma. I guess kind of like a lot of people on the group, I'm not from the UK, if my accent didn't already give it away. I only came for uni, and I would say British culture is interesting to navigate, but I watch a lot of British TV, so I feel like I had a bit of an easier ride. Oh, and I'm from Zambia, just for context. But yeah, Jen, my question was around vulnerability, because you touched on it at some point, and it was just generally the perceptions, I suppose, in like career and academic, especially as an immigrant or someone who may be a first generation person, their family to go to university, or just there's this idea you don't want to like bring, say, maybe the aspects of you that are not like traditional to the field to the forefront, because you don't want to seem like you're reaching out for a handout. Or just, what are your perceptions around vulnerability in the workplace or just generally?
Okay, Michael, this is your time, man.
Yeah, look, thank you. And thank you for that. So the example I gave you at Odgers when I started, I completely get when you're going into the workforce, you know, you don't want to necessarily be talking about other facets of your life which you think will differentiate yourself. But I think ultimately in terms of your point, it's about, and I think this relates to Jonas as well, in terms of you're going into work and being you, right? So again, you're new to the city. You are unique because you've been one of only a small handful being able to get onto this cohort program, okay? So you're desirable in terms of your ability. I think just you going into the organization is being professional. You're not necessarily going to get on with everyone. Let me be very, very clear. You know, the city has got various types of personalities, but your aim is to be a success. So it's about being professional. It's about being light. It's about helping as many people as you possibly can, that you become that glue in that team. And then what's invariably going to happen for you is that opportunities will start to come. People will tap you on the shoulder in terms of, can you do this project for us? So I think just you going into the organization, continue watching Coronation Street, continue watching EastEnders to get used to the cultural nuances. But I really do think you going into work is about being professional, and you will ultimately be able to identify people that you can trust where you can open up and share your vulnerabilities. The reason why I'm sharing my vulnerabilities with you is that I'm in a comfortable space in my career, I'm in a comfortable space of my life, that I'm doing it in a safe environment with people that I know it will resonate with, because there are facets where I've spoken about being a single parent household. There's facets where I've spoken about my brother passing away, police brutality, drugs, adversity, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm not saying that's going to impact every single one on this call, but there will be people that it will impact. So the reason why I'm sharing this with you, the reason why Dawid shares his experiences, is to make sure that you know that you're not alone, that there are others before you who have trodden this path that we can all aspire to. So that's why we're doing it here. But when you get into that workplace, it's head down, it's networking, but there will be mentors there that you will be able to share with.
Michael, our time is gone, but there are three great questions, and I feel like people would want us to deal with these. So I don't normally do this, but we're having such a powerful conversation that I'm going to just try and do this now. So I'm going to bring in Onyeka Chukwu, I'm going to bring in Daniel, and I'm going to bring in Osa Z. Let's keep everybody on screen, and let's bring in all those three, and let's ask a couple of their questions. Let's see if we can deal with them. We don't have to take too long on them, but I just want to hear what they've got to say and the questions, and let's see. But there's some great chat. Michael, thank you so much for sharing your experience with us. Very inspirational. Also, thank you for sharing George. I thought George was really powerful, didn't you think?
Yeah.
Really, really powerful. I thought that was fantastic. By the way, there's a WhatsApp chat that if you're one of the interns, you should be on that. You can share some questions in there as well. But let's have a look. Okay, I'm waiting to get some of these guys coming in. I'm hoping that Daniel Osazi and Onyeka Chukwu is going to come in. But let me ask Onyeka Chukwu's question so that, Michael, we pick it up. Did you at any point in your journey feel like you should be at a higher point or level and you were running out of time? Ooh. And how did you deal with those moments? It's one of the questions that's out there. Just very quickly, let's see if we can deal with that.
Yes. So being a black business owner, give me about a minute to answer this question. So when I was at Odgers, we had a massive brand. We worked on some of the biggest moves in the city. When I set up my own firm, so I was a person leading these transactions. I then set up my own organization, and I got no work from the clients that I've been working with for 4 years. And it took me 10 years to sort of get to the position that I needed to be. So unfortunately, there has been elements where I wasn't where I needed to be. However, there's a big caveat. The city has been very good to me. It's been very good to my family. It's been very good to Dawa. It's been very good to friends. And the support that we've been able to get through 100 Black Interns demonstrates that there's the desire and willingness to make the city more inclusive for all. But sure, should I have been like Dawid, potentially, but I've still got another 20 years to catch up.
Hey, my man, don't bring me into this thing. Daniel, let's hear your question. I'm going to light you up. Daniel, where are you? And let's get your question. Maybe tell us a little bit, who are
Hi.
You? Yeah, hey, how are you doing?
I'm good. Thank you for having me, Dawid and Michael. Yeah, super powerful talk, as always, actually. But yeah, my question, basically what it stems from is that obviously we're going into an environment, and whereas I feel like I've become accustomed to a certain environment, so like, you know, where I grew up on how to navigate interactions in that sense, and then going into this whole new different environment where you have to sort of adapt and change your behavior, that's sort of bringing, I've been a bit worried about it, if I'm going to be honest, because I know the interaction is going to be different, and I know the way I have to move is going to have to be a bit different as well. So I was wondering if you could shed some light on that and how you maybe sort of navigated that sort of whole area.
Can I answer that very quickly? And I'll let Dawid jump in. Thank you for sharing that, Daniel. The reason why I smiled is my first job interview for an internship, I wore a black pair of Gucci loafers, no socks, you know, like the trousers where you can see your ankle.
I got you.
A black tie, but I also had an Armani baseball cap, hey. Right? But Daniel, I looked dope. Like, I looked absolutely incredible, right?
I can imagine.
But before I got through the door, again, it's very fortunate that there's quite a few black security guards. The guy just said to me, you come for an interview? And I said, yeah. He goes, look, bro, take the hat off. Take the long coat off. And I didn't get the internship, but my point is I smiled because I'm 20 years removed from that. But I think ultimately, you know, the workshops that Dawid, Stuart have been putting together should hopefully help you in terms of being yourself and understanding the nuances of being professional in the workplace. So you're not gonna have a problem. You've introduced yourself, you come across well, you're articulate. I think what organizations, and we're doing a lot of work with firms to ensure that they understand the lived experiences of our black interns, right? So in a number of African cultures, looking someone more senior in the eye is about being respectful. Whereas some organizations in the UK may not necessarily recognize that, and they think people are being rude or they're not trustworthy. So we're doing a lot of work with clients, but also likewise, Daniel, that's a great question where you can reach out to me, Dawid, your cohort. I don't know if you want to mention anything on top of that, Dawid, in terms of Daniel's points on that.
Yeah, I think this comes up over and over again, this idea of confidence and somehow feeling like I'm walking into their world from my world. We've all done it, you know, Daniel. We've all been on that same exact same journey. And I think it comes with, like everything in life, it's practice. So the first time you stand up on stage, the first time you give a talk, just coming on here, it's not easy, right? Just lighting up a camera and just knowing that if you ask the question, I'm going to pull you in here. You take some courage, right? You've got to make sure that, yeah, it's not easy. It comes with practice. The more you do it, the more successful you are. And so you show up to your internship. The first day is a little bit, your heart is racing. You feel a little bit like, you know, your collar feels tight. But by the time you get to day five, you realize, hey, you know what? These guys are on my side. Everybody wants you to succeed. And whatever happens at the end of your internship, you're going to have learned an incredible amount that's going to set you up either for a job or for your next gig. You'll be on your CV. I mean, and between now and then, there's so much for us to talk about. Any questions you've got, we're going to do more practice around this. So look, you know, some level of nervousness is natural, but we all have it. Everybody has it. I get it. Everybody gets it. I mean, yeah, everybody does it. I'm going to just ask Osa Z. Come on in, my man.
Good evening. Yeah. I really appreciate Michael for the talk. It was really inspirational. But the question I want to ask is about inferiority complex. And this is not necessarily a competency complex. It's more of a class-based one. So I currently go to the University of Exeter, right? And, you know, it's really posh. You have your students coming in with their signet rings, talking about their 4x4s, their estates, and different things that I can't necessarily relate with. And I don't, and you're talking about being genuine and being authentic. And I've been in the UK for roughly around 6 years because I came from Nigeria, right? And just, I want to be as authentic as possible. I just want to be genuine. I don't want to come across like someone who is living a life that, you know, you've not lived. I mean, I don't have that kind of wealth. So I just want to know, how did you maneuver that social and that class difference? How did you go about doing it?
Right, so it took me time. So again, I'm not as advanced as any of you guys on this call. I wish I was, because I'll be like Dawid, I'll be retired. I can just go off my experience. I still have challenges sometimes around the question that you asked. So I've also got a master's degree from Oxford, right? So I've gone from two GCSEs, playing football, to Wall Street, to owning a company, to then getting a degree at Oxford. And I just think where I am, if I could go back to my, how old are you? 21, 20?
I'm 21.
Damn it, God, you young people. If I can go back to my 21-year-old self, it's a case of, again, they can be your mates. But again, you talk about what you know, right? You can talk about your experiences coming from Nigeria and ask them, hey, look, is it okay if I come back to your estate for the weekend, right? Because I've never been to one before. I'd love to learn more about it. And that's been my approach, right? It's just been one where if I don't know, if I don't come from that background. So when I was 17, in the off season, I went to Israel. I'd done a kibbutz. So one of my best friends at the time is a Jewish guy. That's the person who introduced me to David Sexton, right? So you do stuff where you want to learn. So if I didn't go to kibbutz with Sam and went to Israel for a couple of weeks and got very close with his family, when I was at my lowest, when I was 20, working at the BP petrol station, but because I met David Sexton and his family, he then called and put me on my way to my journey. But I wasn't being strategic. I wasn't being strategic and thinking, oh, I need to meet that person to get access there. I just went out of my comfort zone. A black guy went to Israel. You know, back in like, you know, 20 odd years ago, it wasn't something there. But my point is that, you know, I think it's one where you come across fantastically well. I think it's one where you don't have to talk about signet rings. You don't need to talk about stuff that you don't come from. But I think certainly if there's an opportunity to go for supper or go back with them at the weekend, do it. Hang out with them.
Completely agree. And let me just, I would just add to that, that as most of my Nigerian friends tell me, we are royalty. Make sure that you understand your heritage, my friend. Just because you don't come from, you know, this land doesn't mean that you come from some inferior place. Forget it, not at all. You come from great heritage. And by the way, I find, you know, this is a little secret I'm gonna let you into. I find that a lot of people that wear signet rings that come from an estate wherever, a lot of them are riddled with all kinds of baggage. They got all kinds of insecurity going on that, you know, you're never gonna see it, but it's there. And you just have to tell yourself that just wearing a little signet ring on your little pinky finger doesn't tell you anything about what's going on inside there, right? Doesn't tell you anything whatsoever. And you just got to remind yourself that you are you, you come from a great heritage. The problem sometimes I think with going to somewhere like, you know, maybe like you said, a university has got a lot of those people because you are different. So you feel like that difference somehow, you know, you're looking up to you're looking up to them and looking, you know, you feel like they're looking down. It's not like that, you know, it's not like that at all. You come from a fantastic heritage. You come from, you know, you can trace your lineage all the way back to whenever, you know, you have your own traditions. Mm. If they were in your country, it would be the other way. It'd be the other way around, right? So, you know, you come from one of the greatest countries in Africa, apart from Ghana, Nigeria is number one. We all know that. So, and Zambia as well. Come on, don't worry. I know you guys are all on there. I'm just going to say this, guys. Look, we've had a great chat. We've blown through our time. But look, I want to say that's been one of the best conversations we've had. Michael, thanks so much for being inspiring, vulnerable. It's been a powerful talk. Ladies and gentlemen, you know, we're all like friends together, right? I mean, you know, Michael says I'm retired. Forget it. I'm not retired. I'm working harder than I've ever worked in my entire life.
Hello, Cordella.
My entire life. And got some great comments coming in. Thank you. Thank you so much, Michael. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you. Fantastic discussion. It's coming in, man. Look, it's been fantastic. It's great. Thank you for your honesty. I think honesty is a huge thing. Michael, just wrap for us. Tell us, give us some closing remarks.
No, look, again, David, Stuart, thank you so much to all of the 101 interns on this call. Thank you so much. You fill my heart. There's a number of you that I've spoken to directly over the last 6 months. You are an absolute inspiration to all of us who co-founded this program. I was speaking to Stuart just before the call. We did not expect it to blow up how it's done. And you've done us proud. And I mean that. The quality, the fact that you're showing up every week, twice a week, you're getting prepared for Kilimanjaro. This is why we're prepared to give you guys back time. This is why we're prepared to talk to you. This is why we're prepared to invest in you. So I want to say, look, God bless you. Thank you so much. Feel free to drop me a note on LinkedIn, on the WhatsApp group. Hopefully I can come back and maybe take Dawid's seat when he's having a day off. I think that might be quite good. I can take him out. Perhaps.
Anytime, my friend. Anytime.
Thank you very much for all your time. And David, thank you so much for the invite too.
It's a pleasure. It's all good. It's a wrap, people. We'll see you next Tuesday. Stick around. Stay safe. Stay well. Bye-bye.